do both your songs before. Oh, it didn't come.
No, I had to press the button like 4 times to get it on mute. I don't know.
Well, make sure it's on.
It's on.
Okay.
Morning. Welcome to Pathway Baptist Church. We're so glad you're here. And let's stand and worship the Lord together.
To love you, you are good and you are kind. You bring joy into my life. You make it easy to trust you. You have never left my side. You've been faithful every time. Oh, all I want is you, Jesus. All I want is you. You are the refuge I run to. You are the fire that leads me through the night. I follow you. To trust you, nothing to fear, for you are by my side. I follow you anywhere. Oh, Jesus, you came to my rescue, took my place upon the cross. You redeemed all I had lost. Now my whole world revolving around you. You're the center of my life. You're the treasure. You're the prize. Oh, all I want is you, Jesus. Jesus, all I want is you. Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, oh, all I want is you. Jesus, all I want is you. Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, oh, all I want is you. Wherever you lead me, whatever it costs me, oh, all I want is you. Jesus, all I want. I'll follow you anywhere. There's a million reasons to trust you. Nothing to fear for you are by my side. I'll follow you anywhere. Follow you anywhere. I'll follow you anywhere. I'll follow you anywhere. These are the days that we pray for. Stirring of faith as we go. And I see so much, still I'm certain that the best is not yet come. 'Cause Jesus, you're not done with me. You're doing doing a new thing. And I see a wave of revival preceded by justice and praise. We young and the old run to Jesus. Oh, and I see that. Jesus, you're not done with me. You're doing a new thing. You're doing a new thing. For all I see, I still believe. You're doing a new thing. You're doing a new thing. He's never gonna give up. He never give up. He never give up on me. Your love is never gonna give up. He never give up. He never give up on me. Your love is never gonna give up. He never give up. He never give up on me. He never give up on me. Your love is never gonna give up. You never give up. You never give up on me. Your love is never gonna give up. You never give up. You never give up on me.
Father, we thank you that you are doing a new thing in our lives, that you brought us to you by allowing us to accept you as our Savior. We thank you, Father, for what you've done. And Father, we want to praise you this morning, and we thank you for the opportunity to be here and worship in your house. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to Pathway. We're delighted to have you brave the mist and the rain this morning and worship with us. If you're watching us on our live stream, we'd like for you to go to pathwaybaptist.com/connect. And for those of you here, you should have a card that looks something like this. This is our connection card. It's a way that we have of being able to connect with you. And if you would take that card and fill it out, as much information as you're comfortable with, but if you could give us, at least give us a name and an email address, then that allows us to provide information for you about Pathway. And on the back of that, there's a request form. In other words, there's blocks there. And if you would like to know more about Pathway or small groups or whatever, then we'll give that to you. And also, probably the most important part is if there's something that you would like for us to pray for you, it'd be the private or public, but we as a staff will pray for you this week. So be sure and fill that out. So let me give you just a few minutes to fill that out. If you are a first or second time visitor, we would encourage you to take up a mug and as a small gift for you. And Mike Trace, alias Vanna White, was demonstrating the mugs back there. Okay, announcements. Pathway Women, the women's ministry, have adopted a name for themselves. They're Pathway Sisters. Now, that's an acronym. And if you'd like to know what that acronym is, you have a chance at 2:30 this afternoon to meet with the ladies at 4866 Cedar Ridge Drive. That's my address. Okay, y'all come on. But I think we have some of us guys have a meeting today, but at 2:30 on Sundays, also at 6:15, if you can't make the Sunday, then you can make the Wednesday night at 6:15 here at the church. We've got a big event coming up February the 28th, and that's worship night. And also, in way of announcements, the 18th, we will have a business meeting here at the church starting at 4 o'clock. And we're back in the groove now, and Wednesday nights, our college ministry, Thrive, and our high school ministry, Fuse, and our kids ministry, Pathway Kids, is back on schedule. And also our small groups have started. If you have not had the opportunity to join a small group, if you look up there at that QR code, you should be able to scan that, and that'll take you, give you information on the small groups and let you be able to join up. Our second and fourth graders are going back there with Mike. I'll give you a chance to do that. And if you would stand and worship, Jeremy's going to start a new series this morning called Come and See. Thank you.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I hope, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Well, shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. Oh, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And there's power that can break up every chain. And there's power that can empty out a grave. In this resurrection power that can save, this power in your name, this power in your name. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your
gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing. All is mighty yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my need, His power is to stay. To this I hope, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ. weight I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus paid and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I owe, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released. I can sing, I am free, and not I, but through Christ. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home, and day by day, I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I
let's pray together this morning. God, as we come to You today, we just ask You to be with us as we worship. God, having Christ, God, having Him as my Savior is what gives me the strength and the ability to do anything, to serve You, to tell others, much less just to wake up every day. God, just be with us as we look to Your Word. And this month, as we're motivated to ask others to come and see. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it is a beautiful Sunday to stay inside, but I'm glad you all got out and came here this morning. And hopefully you did the same thing yesterday for the most part. Although I do appreciate we had a handful of people helping Rhonda and Kenneth get her brother and his roommate moved. And when they got there, a couple of them mentioned that when I asked for help to move that I didn't say anything about it being on the third floor. And I said, you remember that I have a background in sales. And had they read the fine print, the address had apartment 320. If you know anything about Fayetteville apartments, that would say the third floor, but it's not my job to tell you all the fine print. But I do appreciate all those who came, and just a little over 2 hours knocked that out with a little bit of rain and everything else yesterday. But it is good to be here today, and as we start worshiping, as you can see on the screen, we have, and we talked about last week, we're starting a new series. This new series that we're calling Come and See, because multiple times in the scripture and some of the stories we're going to be talking about, you're going to see this phrase used time and time again. And last week we talked about, and really over the last month, one of the next steps then is very similar to a next step you're going to see often going forward for right now, but is that one of the things we are asking our church family to do this year is to set a priority on telling other people about Jesus. And right now, we're not even saying to go out necessarily. And if you want to go out and share the gospel, that is absolutely wonderful. And I will help you do it. Ask any questions you have. Would love to meet with you to find better ways to be able to do that. But simply, for now until Easter, March 31st, so 2 months, less than 2 months, we want to encourage everybody in our church family to invite 5 people to just simply walk with you as you're following Christ. So if it's on a Sunday morning, to invite them to come worship with you. If it's a small group, if it's women's Bible study, if it's you know, for Fuse, for our teenagers or Pathway Kids or Thrive, whatever it is, just from now until Easter, to talk to 5 people and say, come and see. My faith is important enough to me that I think it's something that I would love to introduce you to. So just come and hear about this Jesus. Come and hear about how he's changed my life or how he's changed other people's lives. Just come and find out more. And so we're giving you a great opportunity, right, on February 28th on worship night. Like Larry talked about, we have a lot of things coming up. Worship night is, it's just become one of those things that seems that it hits at the right time in our church family's life every year. And so that Wednesday night, we would love for you to not only join us, but ask someone else to come with you. And so for the next 2 months, that's something you're going to hear me and just kind of remind you of a couple of times, but that is an important thing. And Larry did talk about business meeting we have coming up. We made like a last-minute change to the time, thankfully the AV team even got the slide changed quickly, but it was 4 o'clock at 9 o'clock this morning, but it changed to 4:30 by about 9:45. So because we're trying to make room for everything that Sunday, business meeting on the 18th will be at 4:30 that day. We also have, I know some of you have talked about taking the Pathway class. It's something that we have every so often just to be able to let people know more about our church, about what we believe, about our vision for ministry. If you are interested in that, on the back of your connection card today, we're choosing between February 25th or March the 3rd. And what we do for the Pathway class is you come in, and after worship that morning, we bring in food, we have lunch, and then we're here till about 3:30, child care provided, things like that. So if you aren't interested in doing that, mark on the back of your card and put either February 25th or March 3rd. And I will tell you this, just because you put that date down doesn't mean that we're going to pick it. I try and get everybody and the most people to take it as we can. But it does mean you'll be on my list next time and your choice will be the preference, right? So if we ever schedule it and you can't attend one that we have, I'll make sure that the next time that everybody meets your schedule. And so you can do that. But we do have a lot of things going on. I just wanted to address it quickly this morning for a little bit. If you're on Facebook, if you're friends with me or my wife, you know my family has a lot going on. She's not here today because of flu-like symptoms, tested negative for everything, but feels bad. But she was diagnosed this past week with lymphoma. And so for those who don't know, she actually went through breast cancer was diagnosed back in 2009, and bilateral mastectomies, chemotherapy, hormone therapy, major issues with skin and multiple reconstructive surgeries. And so it's been a long road for her. And in December or early January, one of the two, she finally got released from her oncologist as being clear. So that was great. And then in January, started having some complications, and over the few weeks we've been dealing with this and found out that she does have lymphoma. We still don't know exactly what kind. We still don't know what kind of treatment. We're meeting with a surgeon on Monday, and honestly, he may not be able to tell us much because we still don't have results back. So we don't have a lot to tell you except that, do definitely pray for her. If we can stay away from chemo or radiation, then we'll call it a win. We are facing surgery no matter what. We are facing complete surgery there and everything else. Do be in prayer for her. And sometimes, you know, people will often remark to her over the years and stuff that it seems like she handles it well, right? And sometimes I can seem like it doesn't bother me. It does. A movie I really like, if you know me, I like history, and so movies about history are the things I watch on my own because my wife gets bored. There was a Tom Hanks movie called Bridge of Spies. It's based off of a true story, happened back in the Cold War, and you had a Russian spy that was captured in the U.S. And the movie kind of makes you like the Russian spy, but it's okay for two reasons. A, he got caught, and historically, he was very unsuccessful at his job. And so, like, he never actually spied anything worth reporting, and he got caught. So you can like that kind of spy. But you do kind of like this guy through the movie. And when Tom Hanks is his lawyer and he's talking to him, and I have this quote, a few of these quotes that bounce around like in the back of my head, but he talks to him in jail when he first meets him, and he mentions that I'm the only, you know, Tom Hanks as his lawyer says, I'm the only one not pushing you to the gas chamber. And the guy just kind of agrees, right? Or the electric chair. And Tom Hanks asks him, you don't seem alarmed. And his response is, would it help? And then later when they're in court and they're about to, he's about to go on trial and be, you know, found guilty and everything else. And Tom Hanks asks him again. He says, don't you ever worry. And he just responded with the same thing. Would it help? And so I can tell you this, that Jessica is worried. So am I, right? A lot. And I was last time, too. We've been through this before, so for us, sometimes the bad thing is knowing what's happening, right? When you face a trial or you face a problem in life, sometimes the first time you have no idea what you're about to face and you just enter it all fresh and new and you have that kind of anxiety. This time we have a different kind of anxiety, knowing that we can get through anything, but man, we're going to hate it. We're going to hate it. And so what I want to say is there was a reason we were able to make it through the first time, and there's a reason we'll be able to make it through this round or whatever else we face. And that's because in our faith, we know the end of the story. And I'm not saying that there's not been periods of anger at God in our house or questioning why, that there's not tears that are shed, that there's not anxiety or depression or anything else. I'm not telling you that those things don't happen in the Flanagan household and haven't over the years, because they have, right? What I'm saying is that at the end of the day, if you are a child of God, whatever could possibly happen during this life, whatever possibly could happen to you now, as horrible as it could be, will never overshadow what Jesus Christ has done in the eternity of every believer. Never. No matter what we face, good result or bad, whether our prayers are answered or whether they're not, whether we struggle and succeed or whether we struggle and we don't, nothing will ever overshadow what Jesus has done for me, what he has done for my wife, and what he has done in the life of every believer. I just say that because our story of faith is not perfect. It is not without all of those negative emotions and all of those hurts, fear, anger, anxiety. It's not without any of those things, but it is our story of faith. And in the end, we have a confidence about eternity because of what Jesus has done, not because of what I've done, and not because of how things are working out today. That has no bearing on Jesus and my eternity, right? And so that is our story, right? That's ours to share. Trust me, Jessica has shared that with a lot of people. She has had people all over the state, all over the country over the years who have reached out to her, and she has been able to talk to them about faith through difficulties and other things because of what Jesus has done for her and that she has endured because of her faith, right? Not because we're strong or not because we're special, but because of our faith. And so for us, that is our come and see story, right? That is it. And you're going to hear over the next 4 weeks, you're going to hear four different points of view of people that there are different reasons they tell someone else to come and see. And so, you know, for us on the other side of this, there will be other opportunities to tell people about having faith through trial and difficulty. There are times in my life where my story about, hey, come and see about Jesus is because I was broken and I was sinful and I still felt God's forgiveness in my life, right? And so come and see the one who will forgive me in spite of what I've done. There's the story that we're going to talk about today, which is more excitement about this is what we've been looking for and we think we have found him in Jesus of Nazareth. Come and see. Right? And so over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be talking about these things. And what I want to tell you is that that everything in life, everything that happens to us, and if you want to know my stance on Reformed theology or Calvinism, come take the Pathway class. But in short, that's not something I prescribe to, so I don't feel like God decided Jessica's going to have lymphoma. I do feel like whatever happens in our life, that it can work to good for those who are called according to God's purpose, which means that since we are following God, and since we are staying faithful, even when we're mad at Him, even when we're angry at Him, even when we have anxiety, even when we have fear, that even in those moments, that if we continue to follow God and are called according to His purpose in life, that He can use the bad things that happen to us for good, right? And so, whether it's bad stuff and because Jesus gets you through it, that's why you tell people to come and see you, or whether it's you're excited about what you have found, whatever it is, we all have a reason if you are a believer in Jesus Christ. And so if we aren't asking others to come and see, that's the question, right? The question isn't, do you have a reason to invite others to walk with you? If you're a believer, the question is, why aren't you? That's the question you have to answer. So in this story today, what we're going to see is the calling of the first disciples, right? And it's been a few years now, but I preached a sermon once about when Jesus came up to the boat of Simon Peter and Andrew, and they had been fishing all night long and had caught nothing, right? You can find this in three of the Gospels. Matthew chapter 4 is where I was reading it last night. But you can read through that story, and it's the story of these fishermen who caught nothing overnight, so they weren't horribly excited when Jesus said, let's go step back out in the boat and let's cast our nets again. And they're like, well, we've caught nothing, right? In morning time, when the sun has come up, is not the time to fish. And they follow Jesus, his command. They cast out their nets. And if you know the story, their nets were so full that they had trouble even bringing them in, right? And so they were bursting at the seams. And at that moment in time, Jesus told them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. And it says they dropped their nets. They just left everything behind and they followed Jesus. And that story that I talked about in a previous sermon was kind of explaining why these men, Peter and Andrew, and also at that same time James and John, were ready to drop everything and just follow this Jesus Christ. The reality is that wasn't the first time they met him. It wasn't the first time they had heard him. It wasn't this random guy shows up, does one miracle, and boom, you go, right? This wasn't the first time that they knew of Jesus. And so that is the story we're going to get to today. When Jesus was first introduced to them, and when he was first introduced to everybody as the Messiah. Now, John the Baptist is the one, we're going to be in the book of John chapter 1. And this was written by John the Apostle, not John the Baptist. But John the Baptist is the one who is foretold in the Old Testament that would come and prepare the way of the Lord. And that he would come and he would make the path straight, right? He would prepare the way for the Messiah. And when John the Baptist came and he started preaching, the religious leaders were very interested, more probably skeptical and perturbed, because they did not like anybody outside of their religious hierarchy drawing a crowd. They liked to stay in control of everything. And so when you see the story of John the Baptist at the beginning, know that the people questioning him were looking for a reason to hate him. And so they asked him if he was claiming to be the Messiah, and he said no. Then they asked, are you Elijah? Because there's prophecy about someone in the spirit of Elijah coming. And he said no. And so in John chapter 1, verse 22, they said, then who are you? We need an answer for those who sent us. What do you have to say about yourself? And John replied in the words of the prophet Isaiah, I'm a voice shouting in the wilderness. Clear the way for the Lord's coming. So I'm not the Messiah. I'm not Elijah. But I am a fulfillment of prophecy. John the Baptist told them very clearly. They knew this prophecy out of Isaiah. They knew very clearly that he was claiming to be fulfillment of this prophecy. He was the messenger the Messiah was coming after. And here's what they said in verse 24. Then the Pharisees who had sent him asked him, if you aren't the Messiah or Elijah or the prophet, what right do you have to baptize? John told them, I baptize with water, but right here in the crowd is someone you do not recognize. Though his ministry follows mine, I'm not even worthy to be his slave and untie the straps of his sandal. And this encounter took place in Bethany, an area east of the Jordan River where John was baptizing. So it wasn't, they weren't like questioning, so you say you're fulfilling this prophecy. They didn't really even question that. They just said, well, by whose authority are you doing this, right? Because to them it was all about, you. If you're not coming under our authority, then you have none. But John was just simply saying, I'm here to say the message that the Messiah is coming. I'm not even worthy to untie his shoe. You keep going in verse 29, and it says, The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is the one I was talking about when I said, a man is coming after me who is far greater than I am, for he existed long before me. I did not recognize him as the Messiah, but I have been baptizing with water so that he might be revealed to Israel. Then John testified, I saw the Holy Spirit descending like a dove from heaven and resting upon him. I didn't know that he was the one, but when God sent me to baptize with water, he told me, the one on whom you see the Spirit descend and rest is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. And in verse 34, John the Baptist, he's telling the disciples who are with him, right? The same ones that were following him the day before. And he said, I saw this happen to Jesus, so I testify that he is the chosen one of God. So John is telling everyone that Jesus is coming. And he has followers, right? He has followers. Even after Jesus calls his own followers out, right? And Jesus is on the scene, John still has people who are following him because he is out there preaching the Messiah is coming. And so he tells them that I baptized Jesus, and you can go find that account in multiple other gospels. But when he baptized Jesus, the Holy Spirit descended, right? And said, you know, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased, right? Came down in the form of a dove. And so you see this happening in Scripture. And we don't know who all witnessed it. We know there were witnesses. Is it possible that John the Baptist's disciples that he's talking to now were there? Possible. Is it possible they weren't there and that's why he's explaining it? Possible. Could be a mixed group. We don't really know. But here's what happens. And it says the following day in verse 35, John was again standing with two of his disciples. And I would assume that the disciples he was talking to here in John 1:35 were probably with him the day before when he was explaining this. I'm assuming that they've heard these stories about Jesus being baptized, about the Holy Spirit descending in the form of a dove, about God calling out, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased, right? I am assuming that they know this, but it is just an assumption. But John is standing with two of his disciples, and in verse 36, as Jesus walked by, John looked at him and declared, look, there is the Lamb of God. And when John's two disciples heard this, they followed Jesus. Jesus looked around and saw them following. What do you want? He asked them. And they replied, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? And Jesus, in the first time we see this response, said, come and see, he said. And it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon when they went with him to the place where he was staying, and they remained with him the rest of the day. Now, very simple story, right? And a couple of things happened in between there. Jesus was baptized. Very possibly before this part happens, he was also tempted by Satan in the desert. We're not exactly sure on the timeline of all those things. If you read the book of Luke, it is like very, very timeline specific. If you read Matthew, he's all over the place. And so it's sometimes hard to pull all the gospels together and get the exact timeline, but Jesus was baptized, probably had gone through the temptation where he was tempted by Satan 3 times. And here is back, and at this point in time, John first introduced his disciples and says, here is Jesus, and they start following. Now, we've talked about the last, you know, month and really looking at our purpose statement, and we can never show that enough, so go ahead and throw that on the screen again. Our purpose statement at Pathway is that we are here to create a community that's equipped to bring Christ to our city. And teaching and sermons, right, that's hopefully equipping, hopefully, if I do a half-decent job. If not, small groups will definitely do that, right? Personal Bible study, things like that, one-on-one conversations with people, getting to know deeper in the Word, training on how to talk to people. All right? And you're like, well, we talk to people every day. Well, yeah, but the more that you train in how you want to talk to people, it helps, right? They had on-the-job training with Jesus for years, and so don't think that we don't need it to work on it. And so all these things are the equipping, but at the end of the day, everything we do should be focused on bringing Christ to our city, and part of that is giving people a reason to come and see. In our life, in our example, from our testimony, just the fact that we're excited enough about what we're doing, you know, like, you know what, I go to church, and I've gone in my whole life, and it's one of those things we're supposed to do. You know, come with me. Well, that sounds horrible. And that's the point, right, is that when Jesus told them to come and see, they said yes, because they had been looking for the Messiah. That's why they were following John the Baptist, and then John the Baptist said, here he is, right? They definitely had a reason when Jesus said, come and see, to say, yes, sir, and they followed along. And they went after him. And in verse 40, it says that Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of these men who heard what John the Baptist said and then followed Jesus. We think the other one was probably John the Apostle who wrote the book, because anytime it references the disciple and never names him, it's virtually always John himself. He doesn't name himself, which sounds good, but then he talks about the disciple that Jesus loved. And so, all right, that's a little much. It's a little bragging. But, so it's probably Andrew and John here. That's who most people believe that this is. It's who I believe it probably was. And Andrew, it says in verse 41, went to find his brother Simon and told him, we have found the Messiah, which means Christ. Then Andrew brought Simon to meet Jesus. Looking intently at Simon, Jesus said, your name is Simon, son of John, but you will be called Cephas, which means Peter. And so, here at the very beginning, you see that Andrew and John were these disciples following John the Baptist. And John the Baptist said, that's the Messiah I've been telling you about. There's the Lamb of God. And they follow him. Now, we can get into a lot of different reasons about why they're ready to follow. And even with, you know, the story of the miraculous catch of fish, why they were ready to drop their nets and go. Part of that is the way that it was a privilege to be invited to follow day in, day out. A famous rabbi, right, or a teacher. Because if you were invited to actually follow him, then it meant that he saw something in you that you may one day be able to be a rabbi or a teacher as well. But all of that aside, there's no other rabbi that anybody said, this is the Lamb of God and the Messiah. There's no other rabbi that the Spirit of God had declared who he is when he was baptized. There's nobody that could fill a boat with fish like that. There's nobody who could heal Simon Peter's family that you see. And there are a lot of things that actually happen, from Jesus driving the money changers out of the temple for the first time, more than likely his story with Nicodemus and the healing the healing of Simon Peter's family, and other things that happen between this story here in John 1 and when he finally said, you know, come and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. And so all of these things were going on, but Andrew and John trusted that this is what they've been looking for. And so they not only followed Jesus, but they started going and telling other people to come with them. In verse 43, we keep going. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, come, follow me. Philip was from Bethsaida, Andrew and Peter's hometown. Philip then went to look for Nathanael and told him, we have found the very person Moses and the prophets wrote about. His name is Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth. And here I love in verse 46, it says, Nazareth, exclaimed Nathanael, can anything good come from Nazareth? And then, come and see for yourself, Philip replied. So one of the common thing that you have to understand in this story is that all of these people, from Andrew and John to Peter to Philip to Nathanael, were on some level, more than likely, already disciples of John the Baptist on some level, knew of the Messiah, because obviously even, you know, we don't know much about Philip and Nathanael at this point, but Philip says, this is the very person Moses and the prophets wrote about. So they were all looking for Jesus. They just didn't know who he was. They all wanted to follow the Messiah, and now they're being told, here he is. And so Philip is pretty much exclaiming to Nathanael that we have found what we are looking for. We have all been looking for this, and we now have found him. And Nathanael's response, see, here's the thing. Even though Nathanael is one of the people who is desperately hoping that he will get to meet the Messiah, the Christ, the one that the prophets have foretold about from Moses and everybody on down, right? Even though Nathanael desperately wants to meet him, he says, but from Nazareth? How can he be from Nazareth, right? Nothing good comes from that city. Verse 47, as they approached, Jesus said, now here's a genuine son of Israel, a man of complete integrity. And this is talking to Nathanael. In verse 48, how do you know about me, Nathanael asks. And Jesus replied, I could see you under the fig tree before Philip found you. Then Nathanael exclaimed, Rabbi, you are the son of God, the king of Israel. Jesus asked him, do you believe this just because I told you I'd seen you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than this. Then he said, I tell you the truth, you will see all heaven open and the angels of God going up and down on the Son of Man, the one who is the stairway between heaven and earth. This very simple story at the start of Jesus' ministry, after he is baptized, after the temptation by Satan, after now that he comes and John the Baptist says, look, there is the Lamb of God, the one I've been proclaiming to you and telling you about, right? After that introduction, the people who have been looking for the Messiah start following him. They start learning from him. This is probably, people think, somewhere in late summer, early fall, you know, of 1 year. And then it's the next spring, more than likely, when Jesus driving them out of the temple and the calling of them and the catching of fish and everything else. So for at least like this 6 month period to even up to a year period of time, Jesus is beginning his ministry and performing miracles and teaching in different ways and in different places. And these disciples are still going about their normal life, but they have started following him and learning from him, learning about him, seeing what he's doing, right, and being a part of his early ministry. All because, starting with John the Baptist, then Andrew, then Philip, people started saying, come and see. Come and see what we have been looking for. Now, at the end of this story today, right, at the end of this story today, here is what I want us to glean from it more than anything. It's always good to know timelines and understand it, because when you go and you read through the Gospels for the first time, you're like, all right, how does this all piece together and fit chronologically? So I always like explaining those things. I like being able to tell you and maybe point out some of the things, like Nathanael, right? Even though he was looking for Jesus, it was still hard for him to believe when he was said, here he is. Because Jesus wasn't everything and didn't solve every problem in his mind about what needed to be solved for it to be the Messiah. Hey, you know, obviously, most people, most Jews were looking for someone of high stature, of great importance. Definitely not someone from Nazareth, right? And so, even for Nathanael, who Philip said, here's the guy we've all been hoping that he would show up. Here he is. Nathanael said, I still don't know. And all Philip's response was, come and see for yourself. Come and see for yourself. So at the end of the day, what I want us to see from this scripture is that these people who were called out to follow Jesus were looking for him in some way. And you may say to yourself, or you may think to yourself, that there aren't people around you looking for Jesus, but there are. There are. They don't always know his name, right? Maybe what they've heard about him isn't great. He's from Nazareth, although no one really cares about that now. Maybe what they've heard about him is great. Maybe the things that they've heard about Jesus don't fit with exactly what they think they're looking for. But you can still invite them through their skepticism or their lack of understanding or just not knowing anything whatsoever to say, come and see for yourself. Because people in our world are looking for answers. They're looking for answers to life's toughest questions. the why are we here, the what is next, to what is our purpose, what is the meaning of life, why do bad things happen to good people, why is there pain, and how do I get through this? If God truly loves me, why am I having to struggle right now? Right? Every person in the world has those questions. Much less the further and the deeper ones. Who is God? Is God truly real? If he is real, why are there so many different views of God? If there are so many different views of God, which one is right? And what does it mean to actually follow him when even people who all believe in the same God, right? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, view what it takes to follow him in different ways. And what I'm telling you is that even here at the beginning, Philip didn't try to answer Nathanael and say, well, you know, your prophecy about where he was born, there's actually some stuff in the Old Testament that points to it not being to, you know, a glamorous place like you're talking about, so you're wrong. Philip didn't do that. What did he do? All right, Nathanael, you got doubts? That's right. Come and see. Come with me. Come and see for yourself, right? Because at the end of the day, you're not going to answer everybody's doubts. And I just rattled off about 20 questions. I get all those. And trust me, it's not easy to answer them. And sometimes I start off my answers to people saying, you're not going to like this answer. Because God doesn't say he'll solve every problem for us, but he will solve the most important one. And then a whole lot else. The most important one, about is he God? Yes. What does it take to follow him? Faith. And what will that do for us? Provide us a home for eternity. You know, I want to close on this passage of scripture. There's a story in the scripture, and I pulled this telling of it out of Mark chapter 5. There's a story when Jesus healed a man who wasn't looking for it, right? And we're going to have some come and see stories like this, right? And this is one that I almost spoke on, but he didn't tell this man to come and see. He healed this man that was demon-possessed, and he was living in the burial tombs. And so pretty much he was just hanging out in cemeteries. So trust me, I've been in a seminary. They feel like burial tombs at times. But living in the cemetery, sleeping in the tombs, no one could bind him up. Demons gave him strength, and horrible, horrible life. Jesus came, he healed that man, cast the demons out, killed a bunch of pigs. Go read the story, Mark chapter 5. And then this man was sitting, clothed in his right mind, and he was talking to Jesus. And it says here, Mark chapter 5, verse 18, as Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. But Jesus said, no, go home to your family and tell them everything the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been. Here's what I want to leave you with. How much knowledge did this demon-possessed man have about Jesus? Virtually none. Most of the conversation that they have recorded in Scripture was between Jesus and the demons. This man, all he had is the story of what Jesus had done to him. And Jesus is saying, I understand why you might want to follow me, right? You want to be around the person, and you want to learn more, and you want to experience the goodness and the greatness of you know, like for us, right? The thing we could say is we love being a part of a church family, and we love Christian community, and we love learning and Bible study and everything else. And just like, I get that. But you have everything you need to go back home to your family and to tell them everything the Lord has done for you and how merciful he has been. We have the privilege of gathering together as a church family, of being able to get together with others and study God's word together, about when we are hurting or we need help to have other people who can come and surround us. We have a great privilege, right, of that. We have a blessing of that. But we can't simply stay there in the boat, because Jesus wants to tell each and every one of us that we know everything we need to know to go tell other people what he has done for us and how merciful God has been. As our worship team comes forward and we prepare for a time of response, the gospel is simple, right? Like I said, that God is who he says he was, that Jesus said what he was did what he said he was going to do, right? He lived a sinless life and he died a sacrifice for us, and that all it takes is putting your trust in him Not yourself, not anything else, right? That is it. And if you have trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have everything you need to be able to tell someone, come and see, come and see, right? We have that message as believers. And if you're here today and you've never trusted in Jesus Christ, I would love to share with you what he's done for me. I would love to share with you, answer any question you have about what Jesus wants to do for you. And so if you're here today, I'm going to be standing up over here worshiping. If you have a question about placing your faith in Jesus Christ, I would love to talk to you. But if you are a child of God, if you are a believer, then the only question we have to answer is, why aren't we telling other people to come and see? Why aren't we saying, what he's done for me is so good, that I want other people to hear about it? That's going to be my challenge to us this month. Let's stand together and let's worship.
Of the divine, so free, so infinite your glory, that I am yours and you are mine. By the cross of Jesus Christ, every sin was bought. Every fear was lost, every city raised. When Jesus took the cross, he took my place. By the cross of Jesus Christ, every sin was bought at the highest price. Every fear was lost, every city raised. When Jesus took the cross, he took my place. Then sings my soul, then cries my heart, till kingdom come, till heaven's fight. Till he returns or calls me home,
Christ alone. Then sings my soul, then cries my heart, till kingdom come, till heaven's far, till he returns. Oh, calls me home, I'll praise the name of Christ alone. And sing my song and cry my heart till kingdom come, till love is fine, till he returns. Oh, call me home, I'll praise the name of Christ alone. By the cross of Jesus every sin was bought at the highest price. Every fear was lost, every sin erased. Jesus took the cross and took my place. By the cross of Jesus Christ, every sin was bought. Every fear was lost, every sin erased. And Jesus took the cross and took my place. And Jesus took the cross and took my place. Jesus took the cross and took my place.
And would you take a seat for just a second? This card that talked about earlier, if you would pull that back out. A couple of things. Number one is next steps. So what do we do from what we've heard? And there's two things we're asking you to do this morning. Number one is invite at least five people between now and Easter to come and see. Now, Jeremy said earlier, come and see what? Well, you can invite them to our corporate service on Sunday morning. You can invite them if they have kids and teenagers, then invite them to Fuse. Invite them to Pathway Kids. The thing is, do you know who has the most influence in this church? It's not the ones on the stage. It's you in the pews. You see, because you know a lot of people, and we are convinced that the best way to reach those people is not social media, it's not emails, it's not any other way you can imagine, it's simply one-on-one contact. So invite, come and see. Second, we've got worship night coming up the 28th. And start praying now, not for just that night, but between now and that night, for God's Spirit to stir us all up, because He is worthy. And then after you have a chance to, if you have prayer requests, fill these out. When we leave here in just a second, if you'd drop them in the baskets at the back, that would work. Now, if you will stand, I'd like to pray over you. Father, we do come to you, and we thank you from the bottom of our heart that at one time someone in some fashion said, come and see. And because we came, Lord, and saw, we accepted you as our Savior. Lord, we were convinced that we were lost without you, that we couldn't be restored to God based on our own merits, but Lord, that you had died for us, and that by accepting you as our Savior and asking you to save us, Lord, we are restored. And Father, we pray now that you give us the courage, the strength, Lord, just the intentionality to invite people come and see. We thank you for that privilege. We thank you that you've given us as ambassadors. And Lord, we want to honor that commitment. We praise you for who you are. We praise you, Lord, for what you're going to do. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You're dismissed. Stay dry this afternoon. Sun's coming Monday.